So in this video, I am going to derive all the relations given in the current electricity. So now let's begin the derivations of current electricity. In this, I'll write only the mathematical steps and theoretical portion. I'll simply explain. Now let's commence with the first derivation, I is equal to NEAVD. So here to derive this, we know that I is equal to the charge per unit time, but if you know when this conductor is connected across a cell, then the electron will gain a velocity in the opposite direction of electric field, and that velocity is only called drift velocity, and it is represented by Vd. Now if we write the formula for current, the total charge per unit time, then the total charge will be equal to Ne, where N is representing the number of electrons and E is the charge of the electron. Now this can be written as Ne by T. Now if you represent N, the small n, as the number of electrons per unit volume, then it can be written as N per unit volume. Now I can replace this capital N as small n into volume times the charge of the electron by T. But we know that volume is equal to area times length. Therefore, N times area times length times E by T. Now we can write this as NEA and L by T, and that L by T is nothing but distance by time, which is known as the velocity, and in this case it is drift velocity. Therefore, I is equal to NEA Vd. So this is the first derivation in current electricity. Now let's talk about the second derivation, that is deduction of Ohm's law. So deduction of Ohm's law, J is equal to sigma E, or the other form is V is equal to IR. To derive this, we should take the velocity of the electron, that's nothing but drift velocity. Now as the electrons are moving very randomly in the conductor, therefore there is no preferred direction for velocity. Therefore, the average velocity initially is taken as zero. So now when we write the equation V is equal to U plus AT for an electron, you can write Vd, that is drift velocity, is equal to zero plus acceleration and tau, the time of relaxation between two consecutive collisions. Now we have derived just now I is equal to NEA Vd. Therefore, Vd can be written as I by NEA. Remember, here this A is the area of cross section and this A is acceleration. So now we can write acceleration as force by mass. Now, if we wanted to write F in terms of E, we know that F is equal to Q times E, and here in the case of electron, it is E times E. So, E times E by M times tau. We know that I by A is defined as the current density. Remember, current density is a vector and the direction of the current density is the direction of the current. So here in this case I by A can be replaced by J by N E, which is equal to E times E by M and tau. So this implies J is equal to N E square E by M into tau. If you observe this right hand side, all are constants, therefore except E. Therefore, it can be written as J is some constant into E. That constant is only known as conductivity. So, J is equal to sigma E, where sigma is equal to N E square by M times tau. We know that conductivity is the reciprocal of resistivity. Therefore, you can write the reverse of it as rho, the resistivity, which is equal to M by N E square tau. So this is the first form of Ohm's law. Now if we wanted to derive V is equal to IR, then again we will take this equation I by N E A is equal to E E tau by M. So now here this capital E electric field can be written as the potential per unit length. So now if you replace that, this I by N E A is equal to E tau by M, and then this is V by L. This V is potential difference. Now if we shift this I to this side, so V by I is equal to ML by N E square tau A. Therefore this right side quantity is constant, and that constant is only known as resistance. So V is equal to IR is the other form of Ohm's law. Now, when we write R is equal to M by N E square tau L by A, it clearly indicates that the resistance is directly proportional to L and inversely proportional to area of cross section, and by combining we can write R is directly proportional to L by A, which implies R is equal to rho L by A, where this rho is called specific resistance, R resistivity. And if you compare these two equations, the value of rho is equal to M by N E square tau. The resistivity depends on the temperature and the nature of the material. Now let's derive the effective resistance is equal to sum of the individual resistance in series. So here this is R1, this is R2, and this is R3, and this is cell, and it is key. Now when the key is closed, a current I is drawn through the positive terminal, and this I will pass through R1, R2, R3. So I is same, the current is same in all the three resistors. Therefore the potential drops across R1 be V1 and R2 be V2 and R3 be V3. Now if you write V is equal to V1 plus V2 plus V3, because the sum of the individual potential drops must be equal to the net potential difference across the two terminals of the cell. Therefore, according to Ohm's law, I can write this as I times R1 and this as I times R2 and this as I times R3. Now, if I take I as common, R1 plus R2 plus R3, this is all equal to V. Now, if we replace this circuit by a single resistance connected across the same cell, in such a way that it should draw the same current. In that case, V is equal to I times R. Now, if you compare these two, I times R can be written as I times R1 plus R2 plus R3. Now, we can clearly say that R is equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3. So this is the effective resistance when the three resistors are connected in series. Now let's do the next derivation. So here we take the resistors in parallel. We know that in parallel all the three resistors, one end of the three resistors are connected to one point and all the other end of the resistors are connected to another common point, and we have to connect a cell between these two points. Now, in the case of parallel, if I current is drawn through the cell, then there are three paths. So, let's consider that I1 is the current passing through R1, I2 is the current passing through R2, then I3 is the current passing through R3. So here, the individual currents that are passing through R1 and R2 and R3 should be equal to the total current drawn by the cell. Therefore, I should write I is equal to I1 plus I2 plus I3. According to Ohm's law, I can write it as V by R1, because V is equal to IR, therefore I is equal to V by R. So V by R2 and V by R3. Remember, the potential difference is same because the first resistance is connected across the same cell, second resistance is also connected across the same cell, and third resistance is also connected across the same cell. Therefore, I can say that potential difference is same for all the three. Now, if again we adjust the removing all the three resistance and connected a single resistance in such a way that it is drawing I current, then I can write from this equation V is equal to IR. Therefore, this I is equal to V by R. So, which tells me that 1 by R is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. So this is the formula to calculate the net resistance when three resistors are connected in parallel. Cells in series and parallel. Suppose if two cells are connected like this, having an internal resistance R1 and this is EMF is E1. Now another cell which is connected in series having R2 as internal resistance and E2 as EMF. E is equal to V plus I times internal resistance. So this is the relation. Consider that this point is B and this point is C. Now, if I wanted to write VA minus VB, I can write with the help of this equation as E1 minus I R1. So let this be first equation. Now, if I want to write the potential difference between B and C points, that should be equal to E2 minus I times R2. Here I have taken I because in series the current remains same. Now, if I add these two, then we can write VA minus VC, because this VB is cancelled, is equal to E1 plus E2 minus I times R1 plus R2. Now, if I wanted to connect a single cell, replacing the two cells above in such a way that it should draw the same current, then between A and C, and if it is having E, the potential, I mean EMF, and I is the current drawn, and R is the internal resistance, then I can write it as VA minus VC is equal to E minus I times R. Now, if we compare this equation, let it be 3, and this equation, let it be 4, then we get E, the net EMF, is equal to E1 plus E2, and net resistance R is equal to R1 plus R2. So it gives us the information. Suppose if two cells are connected having E1 and E2 as their EMFs and R1 and R2 as their internal resistances, then the net resistance can be directly added. Net EMF can be given E1 plus E2, sum of the two individual EMFs. Now, if one cell is in reverse direction, suppose if E1 is like this and E2 is connected like this, then we have to make use E is equal to E1 minus E2. So, because this cell is connected in reverse order. If we connect a cell having E1 as EMF and R1 as internal resistance, and another cell E2 as EMF and R2 as the internal resistance, then let us find out the effective EMF and effective internal resistance for this circuit. So here, let's consider I current is coming out of it, and then it is obvious that I1 current is passing through it and I2 is passing through this one. Now we can write VA minus VB in two different ways. One, along this path A to B, the other along this path. So first, VA minus minus VB can be written as E1 minus I1 times R1. So this is our first equation. Similarly, VA minus VB can also be written as E2 minus I times R2. That is second equation. Now, if these two are removed and if you connect only one cell, which should represent the net EMF as E and net internal resistance as R, and the current passing through it should be I, then we can write V is equal to VA minus VB is equal to E minus I times R. So let this be third equation. The first case, if you consider VA minus VB is replaced as V, now we can write this equation V is equal to E minus IR, because we considered VA minus VB to be V. Therefore, I is equal to E minus V by R. R, it can be written as E by R minus V by R. Now, we know that the value of I is nothing but I1 plus I2, because we have sent in I current and it is split into I1 and I2. So I1 from the first equation, it can be written as E1 minus V by R1 plus I2 E2 minus V by R2. Now we can write E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2 minus V times 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Now, if we compare this, let it be 4, and this be 5, when we compare these two, we can write E by R is equal to E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2, and 1 by R is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2, which is in turn R1 plus R2 by R1 R2. Now in this can be simplified furtherly as E1 R2 plus E2 R1 by R1 R2. This is all equal to E by R. The value of 1 by R is equal to R1 plus R2 by R1 R2. So now, therefore, E must be equal to E1 R2 plus E2 R1 by R1 R2, and this R goes to that side, and here this should be written as R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. Now you can cancel out these two. Then finally, the effective EMF is equal to E1 R2 plus E2 R1 by R1 plus R2. This is effective EMF, and effective internal resistance is equal to R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. We know that Wheatstone bridge is consisting of four resistors. Let these resistors be P, Q, R, and S. Now this is connected across we arrange one key here and a galvanometer it is attached between the points B and D. Now let's consider that I current is drawn here, then I1 current be moving through the resistor P. Then the remaining current I minus I1 should go through R. Here, if the resistance of galvanometer is G and the current passing through be IG, then remaining current from I1, that is I1 minus IG, will go through Q. Now here, this IG is coming in this direction and I minus I1 is coming in this direction. At this junction, those two are added and through S, the current passing through will be I minus I1 plus IG. Now, if you look at C, these two, this and this are to be added. When we add, we get I. So it is necessary if you draw I current from positive terminal of the cell, you should get back through the negative terminal the same current. That means here the distribution of current is correct. Now, if you apply the Kirchhoff law for the loop A, B, D, A, we can write minus I1 P according to sign conventions. If you are in the same direction, the current is also in the same direction, then potential drop is to be taken as negative. Then here again minus IG times G and plus I minus I1 times R. This is all equal to 0 because no cell is connected here. And according to second law of Kirchhoff, it should be equal to 0. If there is no current passing through the galvanometer, then we call it as balanced Wheatstone bridge. That means if the bridge is to be balanced, then the value of IG must be equal to 0. For that only we are deriving the condition. So now what happens this equation? By rearranging the terms, we can write I1P is equal to I minus I1 times R. So this is our first equation. Now when we take the other loop, then that for loop B, C, D, B, we can write I1 minus IG times Q plus I minus I1 plus IG times s and plus ig times g is equal to 0. And then again let us replace ig is equal to 0 for balanced Wheatstone bridge. Then by rearranging the terms, I'll get I1Q is equal to I minus I1 times of S. So this is my second equation. When I divide 1 by 2, then I'll get P by Q is equal to R by S. So this is the condition for balanced Wheatstone bridge. This can also be written as P by R is equal to Q by S. So here, when the bridge is balanced, the current passing through the galvanometer is equal to 0. The principle of potentiometer. What is principle of potentiometer? A constant current is passing through a wire of uniform area of cross section. That is, I is constant and uniform area of cross section. Then the potential difference is directly proportional to length of the wire. This we have to derive. So to derive this, we write V is equal to IR and R is equal to rho L by A, because R is directly proportional to L, inversely proportional to area of cross section. R is equal to rho L by A. Now here, this specific resistance is constant. I and A are constants. Therefore, V is equal to I rho by A times L. This is K. This K is called potential gradient. So V is equal to, V is directly proportional to L. So this is the principle of potentiometer. E1 by E2 is equal to L1 by L2. So these are the derivations of the topic current electricity. We began with I is equal to NEAVD. This is the first derivation. Then J is equal to sigma E, deduction of Ohm's law, followed by V is equal to IR. Then we talked about R is equal to rho L by A. Then resistors in series, then resistance, resistors in parallel, then cells in series, cells in parallel, balanced Wheatstone bridge, and finally the principle of potentiometer.